Also then, in these years, there was an absence of the, gradually, an absence of the government in big parts of the country. You all know this negotiations in Caguan, that an immense part of Colombia was guerrilla territory. There was no soldier, no policeman, and so on. And it was given to them, and it was all afterwards, it was very clear that you cannot negotiate, because the business, their business was so good that they don't want to take, to give away their business. And that was a big problem, of course, for the government, that well-intentioned, especially with the Pastrana government, well-intentioned to negotiate. So after this, like I say, this post-apertura, you got a few presidents. You got one president who I personally consider a crook, and the other president a very weak person. So the crook was Samper, and the weak president was Pastrana, in my eyes. And they did a lot of bad to the country, one intentionally and the other one by being just a little bit of but in spite of all this, there came a new entrepreneurial generation. The older guys were out. They lived in Miami, they lived in Madrid, they left the country. And middle management and management of the companies all of a sudden came up in managerial functions. And that was the salvation, I think, of the economy in those years, because these people had the desire and the wish and the necessity to improve their performance, improve their companies, and be very creative on their products as well. And moreover, which was very important, they were in the plant and not living far away from the plant or in the land. And they knew how to make things, which most of the time the owners of the companies didn't have a clue about it. So slowly but surely, you got these new ideas in the economy. And that also, you got more less hesitancy in, let's say, investments from the Dutch. Because before that, in that period, there was only Shell in Huila, who was relatively important. There was one guy who was still there in coal, and then there were a few adventurers, basically. There was no real, you had a bit of Philips, of course, but it was small, everything. It was very hesitant. And even if you say today, oil in Colombia, and you compare it with Shell in Huila, that's no comparison. That was all Shell had in the desert there, just this old-fashioned oil exploration. And then the Dutch investment started, and that is basically also the time when I started with the Colombian Business Council. All of a sudden we started to move, Macro bijvoorbeeld. I got Macro enthusiastic about Colombia, and Macro started with local partners, started their shop, so to say, and now they have 14 shops. ABN AMRO, finally, after 3 years of work, I got ABN AMRO in, because they did Colombia only from Miami. But these people did not realize what huge margins were made in Colombia still today. We always said that double the margin you get in, or the spread, in bankers' terms, you get in Afghanistan, you could get in Bogota. And it was immense for the banks, and later we'll come back to that, what the banks have made in money in those years. But also, there was an investment in coal. Drummond, for example, went in a big way, the Americans from Alabama, and also Cerrejón, which is a multinational, went in and has the biggest open pit mine in the world in La Guajira. Nickel with Cerro Matoso took much more interest. And also textile, not only, let's say, jeans cloth, but also finer textile, baby clothes, brochures, which Leonisa is one of the main brochure exporters, I would say, from Colombia. It's funny that all this, that is all handwork, it was no Chinese can beat it. So that was a big strong point of export. But also in these years, and that is the worst, there was easy money. Easy money by the drugs, easy money by the small cartels, very visible, big cars, big parties, a lot of drinking around, a lot of, if you don't do what I do, I'll shoot you, and so on. And that was a very bad thing that entered like a cancer into the whole society. But not so much, funnily enough, in the business society. Because the business society was not the people that were directly threatened, were the people that had worked in it. So they were much more resistant than just the capitalist partners in the companies. And this was the basis for the proliferation of political and institutional corruption, under which the country till today is suffering very, very much. It was, corruption in government institutions, in health institutions, for example, but which is worse also, of course, in the Senate or the Parliament, and so, but also in the juridical system. And those are real bitter words, I have to say, because if you read the newspapers every day and you talk to friends, you see that there are very sad stories about it. Okay, we go now to the present century. I hope I don't bore you with a bit of history, because I think for the context you need a bit of the background, although it is good. So then Mr. Uribe came. Mr. Uribe, strongman, paisa, fast talker, but also a man of power, a one that was obsessed with power. And his first priority seems to be that he wanted to reinstall the presence of people, the presence of people in the country again, of the state in the countryside. And he realized this very rapidly. The fighting against the guerrilla, so more military action. He did this under the umbrella of a big sponsor, the USA, because the USA wanted an ally against the front of Chavez and the small dogs around Nicaragua, Bolivia, Ecuador, and a little bit Argentina. He was, however, unsuccessful on international relations. He was unsuccessful in the battle against corruption, and he was inconclusive on various social matters. But in spite of all that, the sense of security was the most important driver, very abstract driver. And the investments increased. Oil was a big, big boom because a lot of expertise came from Venezuela. And the Venezuelans, of course, they didn't want to continue with PVDSA and moved on to Colombia. Coal increased dramatically, minerals, big scale agro in the Llanos, but also in Valle and Cauca. Distribution, Macro grew, Carrefour grew, Exito grew. You got a complete spirit of innovation. Banking, manufacturing, financial market, trade agreements with other countries like USA and now also with Europe. But there was always one handicap, and that was the peso. The peso grew every day more strong. Then came the Santos government. And the Santos government made a very flamboyant start. They were very lucky. All the coal prices, the oil prices, everything was fantastic as far. And the people had still this sense of security which they got under Uribe. The Santos government focused much more on international relationships, especially with the neighbors, but also further in the world, on trade agreements. And started the fight, which is an uphill battle sometimes, against corruption in the health, judiciary, municipal, local governments, customs, the Bacrim, the paramilitary that said that they were not paramilitary anymore, and now they are Bacrim, so they are criminal. Criminal gangs, so to say, that are very important. The perception now, in the last weeks, is of growing insecurity, but I think that this is just a thing to mention on us. And now I come to the other part. Sorry. And now I'll show some slides. But this one is not so readable. This is a slide of the 10 biggest companies in the country. And the first one is Ecopetrol. And you see in their sales of 2011 how huge they are compared to the other companies. I will not mention them for lack of time, but you see that there are 20 very important, where Carvajal, I think everybody knows Carvajal, Carvajal from Cali, is number 10. But a lot of this is all in petroleum, in oil and gas and so on.